Einstein's Relativity, The Special Theory and the General Theory, Chapter 1. Geometry and Physics. New Modern Translation, 2024. Albert Einstein and Harry Yoon, Translator. Introduction, Chapter 1. Relativity, The Special and General Theory, a popular exposition, was written by Albert Einstein specifically for the general audience in 1916, over 100 years ago. It was initially written and first published in 1917 for the German readers after his return to Germany from Switzerland in 1914, where he had spent most of his young adult life. The book was later translated into English in 1920, upon his rise to fame in the Western world, after one of the most important predictions of his theory of relativity was confirmed by the English expedition team led by Sir Arthur Eddington during the total solar eclipse of 1919. It was right after the end of World War I, in which countries like the United Kingdom and Germany had been in a bitter fight with each other for several years. If you are interested in getting a high-level overview of Einstein's relativity, without much physics background, or even with some familiarity with physics, say, at the level of high school or college freshman physics, this is the best book for you to learn relativity with. One thing to note is that, even though this is not a highly technical book, it is still not an easy book to read depending on your background. To make the book more accessible to a wider audience, we are publishing a series of single-chapter edition booklets, with all new English translation, 2024-2025. We hope that some readers will find these short novella-style booklets easier to digest than the more traditional single book format. Although the whole book is only some 100 pages long, it can be still overwhelming to some readers due to its dense content, much of which they may not be entirely familiar with. For the readers who are interested in learning more on relativity, or physics or mathematics in general, beyond what is explained in Einstein's book, each booklet also contains some additional content as a form of appendix, which covers topics relevant to the included main chapter of the book. It goes without saying that the translator's notes, commentaries, and any additional content are all optional. This single chapter edition booklet is the first of this series, and it includes chapter 1 and only chapter 1 of the book Einstein's Relativity, The Special Theory and the General Theory. Einstein starts the book with a brief account on the relationship between physics and geometry. Relativity is essentially a theory of space and time, and hence it is no surprise that Einstein dedicates the first chapter of his popular book on explaining the physical meanings of geometrical concepts and theorems in geometry, which is a branch of mathematics that also studies space, and geometrical shapes and their placement in space, etc. If any of the readers is interested in learning relativity in more depth, both the special theory and the general theory, then geometry is the basic mathematical tool. Original Preface by Einstein. This little book is intended to give the most accurate insight into the theory of relativity, as far as possible, to those who are interested in learning the theory from a general scientific and philosophical point of view, without having to master the mathematical apparatus of theoretical physics. The book assumes that the reader has completed the equivalent of high school level education, at minimum. Furthermore, despite the fact that it is a short book, reading this book will require a lot of patience and willpower on the part of the reader. The author has made every effort to present the main ideas as clearly and as simply as possible, and generally in the order and context in which they actually arose. In the interest of clarity, it seemed inevitable to me to repeat myself as often as necessary, without the slightest regard to the elegance of the presentation. In fact, I conscientiously followed the doctrine of the brilliant theoretical physicist Ludwig Boltzmann that elegance should be left to the hands of tailors and shoemakers. I do not believe that I have withheld from the reader the difficulties which are inherent in the subject matter. On the other hand, I have deliberately ignored the formal physical foundations of the theory, empirical or otherwise, so that the reader who is not entirely familiar with the subject of physics may not end up like the lost explorer who cannot see the forest for the trees. I hope this little book brings you some happy hours of inspiration. Albert Einstein, December 1916. Chapter 1. Geometry and Physics. Surely you too, my dear reader, must have gotten to know the majestic Tower of Euclid's geometry as a schoolchild, and it is perhaps with not so much love as reverence that you now remember its magnificent structure. You must also remember being chased around on its lofty stairways by your dutiful teachers for so many hours. Because of this past experience, you would certainly regard anyone with disdain if they declared even the most insignificant proposition of this science to be untrue. But you will likely lose this feeling of absolute confidence as soon as someone asks you, "What do you mean then by the assertion that these propositions are true?" Let us begin by giving a little thought to this question. Geometry is based on certain elementary constructs or concepts such as plane, point, and straight line, to which we associate more or less natural and intuitive meanings. Furthermore, it is based on a certain additional set of simple and basic propositions, i.e. axioms, which we are willing to accept unconditionally as true in view of these elementary concepts. All other propositions, theorems, are then attempted to be reduced to these axioms using a generally accepted logical method. A proposition is correct or true, or in other words, it is proven if it can be derived from the axioms in this manner. The question of the truth of an individual geometrical proposition thus leads back to the question of the truth of the axioms themselves. But it has long been known that the question of whether an axiom is true is not only unanswerable by the methods of geometry, but it is also in itself without any significance. It is not possible to ask whether it is true that only one straight line passes through two points. It can only be stated that Euclidean geometry deals with constructs which it calls straight lines, and that it attributes to the straight line the property of being uniquely determined by two of its points. The concept of true that we are familiar with does not really apply to the propositions of pure geometry because we are, in general, so accustomed to using the word true to ultimately indicate the correspondence with a real object. Geometry, however, is not concerned with the relationships of its constructs with the objects of experience, but only with their logical connections with each other. Nevertheless, we often tend to call the propositions of geometry true. On the one hand, this tendency can be easily understood if we take into account the fact that the geometrical concepts correspond more or less exactly to the objects in nature. These real-world objects were, without a doubt, the origin of these concepts in the first place. However, we ought to refrain from giving in to such a temptation so easily, that is, if we intend to provide geometry with the broadest possible logical power. If we see a pair of marked points on a practically rigid body, for example, we also immediately see a straight line or a line segment connecting these two points, or the distance between them, regardless of how these two points are positioned on the rigid body. This is, as a matter of fact, something that seems to be deeply ingrained in our habit of thought. Likewise, we also have a tendency to automatically assume that three points are on a straight line if we can make their apparent positions lined up with one-eyed vision, e.g., by a suitable choice of our viewing location and orientation. If we now add to the set of axioms of Euclidean geometry one additional axiom that, following our habit of thought, two points on a practically rigid body always correspond to the same line segment or distance or line interval, regardless of the position and orientation of the body, then the propositions of Euclidean geometry in its totality become the propositions about the possible positions and other geometric shapes on these practically rigid bodies. Geometry extended this way can then be viewed as a branch of physics. We can now meaningfully ask about the truth of geometrical propositions. This is because, when interpreted within this extended set of axioms, we are justified in asking whether these propositions are satisfied for those real-world objects which correspond to the geometrical constructs. We can therefore state, somewhat informally, that by the truth of a geometrical proposition in this sense, we mean the applicability of the proposition in a real-world construction with the compass and ruler. Our conviction in this regards on the truth of geometrical propositions is, of course, based entirely on our rather limited experiences. For now, we will simply presuppose the truth of these geometrical propositions, and then in the later part of our considerations with respect to the general theory of relativity, we will see that this truth indeed has a finite validity. We will further consider the extent of its limitations at that point. The translator's notes. Einstein starts the first chapter of his popular book with one of the deepest and most fundamental questions in physics and philosophy. What is truth? What is truth, especially in the context of geometry and physics? Einstein's relativity is a rather non-intuitive and even counterintuitive theory. Without clearly understanding what true means, what Einstein teaches in this book or his line of thought may not appear all that natural or even plausible. This becomes even more so when we get to the general theory of relativity. That is why we need to give some considerations to this fundamental question from the outset: whatever do you mean by true? A quick summary. Geometry is based on a certain predefined set of axioms, which we simply accept as true. Given a particular geometric proposition, if it can be reduced to these axioms, e.g., through a logically sound method, then the proposition is considered true in the context of pure geometry. That does not mean, however, that the proposition is true in the ordinary sense of the word, as is commonly used in everyday life. In order to make connection with the real-world experience, we will need to add another axiom to the set of axioms of Euclidean geometry. Two points on a practically rigid body always correspond to the same line interval or distance, regardless of the position and orientation of the rigid body. With its extended set of axioms, we can now give physical meanings to the geometric propositions of Euclidean geometry, e.g., based on the correspondence between the geometrical constructs and the real-world objects. Physical meaning of geometrical propositions. Geometry is a study of space and shapes. Space is one of the most important subjects of physics, and hence it's no wonder that geometry and physics are intimately related to each other. Einstein himself goes so far as to say in this book that geometry is indeed a branch of physics as long as we accept the aforementioned additional axiom as part of Euclidean geometry. Geometry with this additional axiom can be used to describe and explain the physical world, as long as this axiom holds true in the real world. In other words, for example, stating that a certain proposition is true in this geometry is the same as the corresponding proposition is valid in the physical world, with the correspondence between the geometrical constructs and the real-world objects. Straight line. In Euclidean geometry, the idea of straight line is one of the most important concepts. Given two points on a plane, for example, we can draw one and only one straight line passing through these two points. Einstein provides a couple of examples in the book to illustrate that this concept of straight line in the real world is deeply ingrained in our way of thinking, with a caveat that it is based on our limited experience. A distance or interval between two points, in Euclidean geometry as well as in physical world, can then be defined as the length of the straight line segment connecting these two points. In fact, a straight line between any two points corresponds to the shortest path, i.e., with the smallest interval between these two points. In modern physics, in the context of relativity in particular, the aforementioned Einstein's axiom, or its generalization, two points on a practically rigid body always correspond to the same line interval or distance, regardless of the position and orientation of the rigid body, plays an essential role. This is especially so for special relativity, as well as general relativity, with suitable modifications. A casual reader who is new to physics would have never suspected that this seemingly trivial and almost obvious statement will be often implicitly the basis of much of our discussions in this book. What's next? The part one of the book comprises 17 chapters, roughly half of the total 32 chapters across three parts, and it is dedicated to the special theory of relativity, which comprises the special principle of relativity, its historical background, and its consequences. If you are new to relativity, you should first focus on understanding the fundamentals of special relativity, rather than being too ambitious. Modern physics is literally built on top of special relativity. General relativity, GR, is, on the other hand, a mathematical theory of gravitation, which is a rather specialized topic beyond Newton's gravity. GR is also much more difficult to learn than special relativity. The special theory of relativity ultimately boils down to a single set of equations, known as the Lorentz-Einstein transformations. Learning special relativity for the vast majority of people means simply learning how to mechanically use these transformation equations. We will assume, however, that you are reading this Einstein's marvelous book since you want a more deeper understanding of relativity, straight from the horse's mouth. You do not have to finish the entire book, that is, all 32 chapters. Start with chapter 1 and see how far you can go. Remember, you have all the time in the world. Nobody is chasing you. You can always read and reread the same chapter before you move on to the next chapter.